Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, with our main topic today. Well, the Minister of Health, Dr. Hala Zayed, was yesterday warning and saying, calling on people to take good care in case Egypt is could receive a second wave of the coronavirus. Also, how are we going to deal with the coming wave, or to prepare ourselves and prepare our children and pupils studying at school and the university? That's what we are going to know from our guest today, Dr. Nermeen Rushdie, human development expert and HR consultant. Welcome, Dr. Rushdie.
Hi, how are you doing?
Good morning.
It's always a pleasure.
Dr. Rushdie, now we are expecting a second wave of the coronavirus, like what's happening in the whole world. We hope it's not that strong, but yesterday, Dr. Hala Zayed, yesterday and the day before, actually, she spoke in the social, on the media sources, and she was warning the citizens to take good care, to wear their masks. So how do you read her statements?
Dr. Zayed's statements is very clear, as we all aware of, or we are aware about what happened actually in the first wave in coronavirus, and I think this gives us an experience how to handle the coronavirus, especially that it just requires simple precautions, as keep our hands clean, keeping sanitizer around, yes, wearing the mask. So if you went through these precautions, you'll find it simple, easy and feasible and accessible by all people all around. I think her warning serves as much more awareness and reminder to people to just like stick to precaution, because you know, better be safe than sorry. So I think following it and having it announced regularly on the social media will help people to recall the precautions, because you know, sometimes people, yes, just forget or just like take it simple and easy, especially in this season. You know, it's the common cold season, you know, because we are going to have
seasonal
this
flu.
Yes, the seasonal flu. So sometimes people mix it up with the seasonal flu. So I think this, yes, serves as a good awareness for people to, yes, take their precaution.
But do you feel that the citizens and the people in Egypt relaxed or something concerning the second wave?
I think yes, a
it
bit.
It did not start yet.
Yes,
of
it
course.
Didn't.
And it may be very weak. We still don't know.
Yes,
it's a new virus for us.
Yes,
but
and still people mix it up with the seasonal flu, as we,
yes,
just said. Plus, I think passing through the wave before makes people more, you know, confident. We can handle it, we can deal with it, which is compatible to our culture. So I think yes, they are relaxed a bit, but I think that people are starting to grab it up and they are keen to have their masks around. I think by the coming days we will see that people, you can watch it in the street, they are walking around having the sanitizer at hand and,
yes,
stuff. So I think they are just like gearing up.
Do you think that they have self-confidence more than the wave, the first wave started? Everybody doesn't know anything about the coronavirus, and now they have you know, some sort of information, so they know how to deal with it. They wear their mask and they have sanitizers in their hands.
Yes, of course, passing through the first wave was shocking, actually, because people, yes, were just like having severe panic attacks. They didn't know what to do, how to handle it,
yes,
where to go, how things are going around, what they should do and what they shouldn't. So I think it was the panic attack that was really much more higher in the wave than the coronavirus itself. Now that people are aware and they were psychologically prepared by having, yes, it announced from the first wave that the coronavirus will have a second wave and stuff, so people are actually concerned and aware. Yani, I think since the first wave, we all have sanitizers in our bags. Maybe people, yes, are just like a bit loosened up in wearing the mask and stuff, but you will find it in the bag of every person or in his pocket walking around. By having the institutions and establishment on all aspects, governmental and public and private sectors, stressing that, for example, if you went to a mall and you are entering a shop or something, if you are just like, you're not wearing the mask, they will say, I'm so sorry, yes. You are not allowed until you wear the mask. So I think the collaborative efforts by all people around and the self-driven awareness of
and
the
at
people.
At the gate of any foundation, yes, or shop, of course, they have...
The security guy there
and,
to maintain
masks. If you don't have, the person doesn't have, they provide you.
This is a very
this
big
is very
plus.
Good.
Yes, of course, having the you know, the sanitizer and the mask booth at the entrance of every place and scattered around the old establishments. I think yes. Hopefully, it will contain the virus, inshallah.
Yes, yes. So now the people are. Emotionally prepared, and they had a time to read and to search, you know, on the social media and exchange point of views concerning this virus.
Yes, taking into consideration as well that in the first wave we have people around, you know, in the close circle, like in family, in friends, in relative, and people at work who already passed through the coronavirus experience. So this helped people to exchange experiences, help people to be aware of the different symptoms of the coronavirus. As you know, that till now there is no special manual or a reference, medical reference, that we can refer back to know yes. the symptoms of the coronavirus, whether it's like common cold or different, because you know yes. everybody God forbid who already had it, they have different symptoms than the others. So sharing experiences and exposures, taking precautions, I think now people are referring back to take these like immunity things to boost their immunity yes. and to help them to inshallah to be yes. able to fight it
yes.
blessedly.
Yes. Concerning, you were just mentioning the symptoms.
Yes.
So do we have any idea about the symptoms of the second wave? Is it different from the first wave? Because we had some news concerning, because the first wave, they told us it's an, a disease that attacks the lungs.
Yes.
Now they say it attacks the lungs and also the stomach.
Yes. Well, as we just said, there is no just like a unified scientific reference to correct our information. It just all depends on, you know, that not only, and it's not like trial and errors, but people's experience around. Plus, it varies from one place to another, you know, because of the climate and the person, the people's immunity. And for example, in the first wave, some people had their own medical investigation, and they discovered that because of the outcome of this investigation, that they already caught the coronavirus and they are blissfully past it, but they yes. didn't even feel the symptoms. So they serve as a carrier, if we are talking about it from a scientific perspective. And others, they went actually through the whole, you know, slope of the coronavirus, and they took their full duration to recover. So, you know, it's just diversified from one person to another, depending on the physique, the structure, the immunity system, how the person is able to fight it, the type of environment he's living in, how he keep himself just like well-maintained yes. and following the health precautions and stuff like that. Yeah. So as a scientific unified reference, it's not clear. As the symptoms, it vary from one person to another. What we just try to highlight is the basic generic symptoms. Yes, at the first it was attacking just the lungs. Of course, you know that a virus always evolute itself, so by time it becomes more stronger, like the seasonal flu. Every yes. season it comes more
stronger,
yes, stronger than the season yes. before. So I think we have to just like, I think that this symptoms serves as an awareness, because if somebody find that he has a stomach ache, he has to take like 1%, it might be a corona. So he has to keep on watching himself to isolate himself for a while to make sure that it's not corona, and
yes.
so not to be an infectious character.
Yes. Dr. Rushdie, let me remind you, or remind our viewers, that at the start of the first wave of the coronavirus that attacked Egypt, starting the 14th or the middle of February at the start of this year, the World Health Organization praised the way Egypt or the state and the government treated or faced the coronavirus. Do you think that this made people here in Egypt have trust in the government and have self-confidence that their country can, you know, can control this second wave?
Of course, yes, because the precautions and the procedures that were taken during this period of time give people, you know, security and full trust, and you know, this like strengthening and confidence, yes, that the country will pass us through the second wave, of course, yes, inshallah. And actually, when you talk to people around, whether in the clubs or in the, yes, in institutions, they say, no, we are sure that
we are ready.
Yes. We know that our government won't let us on our own. Yes. They will take all the precautions, yes, and we will just follow. So I think, yes, they are prepared. Not only with the precautions that we just said, but also with confidence and faith in the government and in the supportive actions and the proactive action that is, yes, that will be taken.
Yes, yes. So let's now talk about our children and, mm-hmm, students of the goes to school or the university. They go, for example, twice a week or something, mm-hmm, and they study the rest of the week online.
Yes, true.
So we'd like to shed light on how to prepare our children and how to advise them concerning precautionary measures concerning the coronavirus.
Schools actually were taking from the, actually before even the beginning of the academic year, they were taking precautions, and they actually make lots of awareness session to their students, either online before entering the academic year or actually when they went to school. I remember that I had a little son in a school already, so he was always making sure every morning that he's having his tissue in his bag, he's having his sanitizer, and when his sanitizer is just like is about to be empty, he's asking for another bottle to keep it. The school teachers are actually aware. They keep inspecting with the children every day, and they are reminding them every day. So I actually love it, because it helps in creating a proactive citizen who's really aware and is actually, because you know, children are the mirror of the society. So when I have my son coming to me and telling me, "Mommy, I don't have my sanitizer. Where is your sanitizer?" So I actually love it, because this means that we are embedding and building in this health, you know, habits for the children to take, because it, for these children, it will not end by the end of the coronavirus. They will take it as a life procedure. So I think, yes, it's positive and proactive.
Yes, yes. Dr. Rosie, how can we convince our children? Because the children are, you know, always afraid. "Oh, mom, I'm afraid. I would like to go out. I would like always to see my friends. And I want to go to school every day, like I used before. Mm-hmm. I would like to go to the club." Mm-hmm. So how can we convince our children that, yeah, if the state wants us to sit at home or there's a curfew, we have to abide by the, yes, restrictions or something?
I remember that once, yes, my son came to me and said, "Can we kill the coronavirus?" You know, kids, you know. Yeah. Well, let's say we already passed through the experience of, yes, the curfew or staying at home or prohibited from going, yes, out. I think this period and this experience helps or serves to give the children an insight and an awareness. Of course, yes, it was a tough one.
But how can we ease the situation for the children?
I think number one by being
saying, "So what if the government wants us to sit at home? We are going to."
This helps by number one being a role model, because no matter what you say to the children, yes, if he didn't see you doing it, he will not believe.
Yes.
Number two, I believe, is just like talking to the kids and like man to man, and make them understand that it's for your own good. The third thing is trying to fill their time with activities like reading, like drawing, like home activities, family stuff, like playing games, cards and stuff like that. So I think it will help in different, you know, levels in building bond with more bond with the children, yes. In having them enjoy their time, in having them even experience life in a different perspective, because, you know, not everything we want we can achieve, or we can at least reach, because of, you know, there is other circumstances that affects us rather than being able to do, yes. it. So I think by adaptation and talking to them and participating with them in finding out ways to enjoy our time at home, that it's not only going out that will make us happy, yes. we can find our own fun and we can build our own world inside the home, mm. I think this will be a very positive, yes. Approach.
Yes. Dr. Rushdie, how do you see or evaluate the online learning, taking in consideration that, you know, the online learning, the student could stay at home wearing anything, his pajamas, he's not standing upright or sitting upright like he used to sit in the class. You know, there are many things that the online system lacks.
Yes, I think from the past academic year to the current, yes. academic year, actually schools and other educational establishments, they really invested a lot in their, you know, educational platforms, yes. and in their softwares and the programs they are using to help in education. And I always recommend that even if we are staying at home, we have to be well prepared, because, you know, if I'm staying in my pajamas and I'm attending an online class, yes. I'll be relaxed and laid back. But if at
least... Does this affect the concentration?
Yes,
because if the student is sitting in the class in front of his teacher... Yes. That would be different, of course.
Yes, of course. This is why, so I recommend whenever we are doing this, we are having an online class, the children or the learner or the student, yes. has to have a place, and this place is specialized for attending the online class. Like, yes. he has his own desk, or just he has to sit upright, he has, yes. to sit on a chair, so to, yes. keep attentive. Because, you know, now they are having these blended interactive, yes. Classes, so that the learner has to stay tuned, he has to be prepared, he has to be concentrated. To be able to follow up or to respond to his,
yes, and also when the student goes to school, you know, he wakes up early and he goes and stands in the line. There is you know, a kind
procedures.
Of discipline,
yes,
procedures and discipline,
yes.
And also he meets his friends,
yes.
socialize, you know,
yes, of course. For the socializing and meeting his friends, and we are doing our efforts to make the children bond together so they will not lose, yes. Their bond.
I don't mean his friends only. He can meet his friends at the club, anywhere, yeah. or I mean his colleagues.
Yes, we, yes. are trying to make circles, like we're trying to gather them in, like, you know, this online applications, yes. so they can talk together, catch up together, so they will not lose the bond, because, you know, by staying at home, we won't make them feel like they are isolated, or they are just like taken, there is a cut off from the surrounding world. The platforms, I believe that it's all, again, it's always about maintaining an example and setting a rule. So if,
yes.
you set a rule for your child that they have to sit properly on a desk, having their laptop or tablet or whatever, and attending the class and being proactive and being prepared, it will give him the spirit of the school. Of course, it's not like that 100% of staying at school and abiding with the procedures and,
yes.
the daily school routine, but at least he will still feel the same seriousness and the commitment to,
yes.
the school day.
Yes.
I know it's a bit hard, and,
yes.
moving forward from being physical school to an online is a bit, it will take effort and it will take time, but inshallah it will work.
Dr. Rushdie, how do you evaluate the role of the Ministry of Education in dealing with the coronavirus?
I think he really was so insightful. You know, he before even the coronavirus, he was introducing the concept of online education,
yes.
the tablet,
the tablets.
Not having, you know, this backpack full of books. We have the soft copy of the books around. So I think this creates sort of awareness to people about such kind of education. Of course, it was different at the very first beginning, because we were raised up on having these books in our hand, flipping the pages. But when the coronavirus started, and moving forward from a physical school learning to an online learning, people were aware of this kind of learning, they were able to cope faster, and I think it's a very proactive approach.
Yes, yes. And now the world is about to find or discover the vaccine. Did you heard about
this? Yes, I heard about it. I think everybody is really looking forward and they are waiting in anticipation to this vaccine, because I think maybe because, you know, the common cold, it can never be prohibited, but at least it will help in lessening the symptoms, help in faster recovery, help people with low immune system to at least not to take this coronavirus and, God forbid, leads to the death that we heard about last season in the coronavirus. So let's wait and see.
Yes.
You know, science has no end. Yes. And it's always about innovation.
Yes. So how does the field of human development, you as an expert, deal with a disease or a virus like corona?
We deal with it in different perspectives.
Yes.
There is the common perspective, which is raising the awareness of the people, encouraging them to abide with the precautions, having the sanitizer and the mask, and keep washing your hands on a regular basis. And there is the other side, which is the psychological preparation of the people, is that this is a thing that was really introduced to our society and that we have to live with it, and we have to live with it in a way to maintain our health, protect our immunity, and at the same time enjoy our life, because at the very first beginning, of the past wave of the coronavirus, people tend to be panic or scared or stick at home, and some people that I really know myself, they just like they do not allow to meet people, and they just like stay at home locked, and they are disengaging from the society around. But actually it's something that we have to accept and to comprehend and to deal with it. I think now we are more aware, so we can accept it with more being more calm than the way before. So being psychologically prepared make people more rational in dealing with the virus, having their own precautions, know how to handle it if, God forbid, somebody around got the virus. So this is the role of the human development, having people prepared, allowing them to enjoy life with limits. Of course, it will not be just like as we used to do before.
Yes.
We have to maintain social distance. There are certain precautions that we have to abide, taking into consideration that if we cannot have this like 100%, because we know that we are, after the first wave of the coronavirus, we will be back, but to the new life. And the new life, I think, it's not that bad. Maintaining precautions, having sanitizers, it's a positive thing. It's not that really aggressive or a hard precaution that we have to follow.
Yes,
so
yes.
We can still enjoy life.
Yes. I thank you very much for your time and for your valuable information.
Thank
Dr. Nermin Rushdie, human development expert and also HR consultant. Thank you very much. Good
it's
morning to you.
Pleasure. Good morning, dear.
Thank you very much. Well, my dear viewers, we're still having more coming up with my colleague Mahisti Rabia.